So welcome everyone. Okay, in today's session of Fun with Heroes, this is episode 26 session of Fun with Heroes. And as I mentioned, we have covered more than 130 stories till date. So that's an amazing thing. Okay, so let's see what are the stories for this week. Okay. So these are the four stories we are going to cover this week. Okay, so any idea? Who are these people? We have four gentlemen. Okay. So anyone knows anyone? Any face here?
No.
Okay, these are tough ones, yes. And we have different people from different background. There's someone from science background. There's someone who was a part of the 1857 war. Okay, that was the first war of independence. Then someone from the army and someone from is very young revolutionary. Okay, so we have different set of people this time. Okay, so let's start with our stories. Okay, so how many of you like stars in the field of astronomy? Do you like stars?
Yes.
Yes.
I have joined the astronomy club of my school in first grade.
Great, great. So yeah, most people like stars, right? We like to see the stars at night and the planets and different objects in the sky. So the world of stars, planets, galaxies and universe is a fascinating one, right? And our first story is of a renowned scientist who did research in this area and was a leading expert in this field of astronomy. So his name is Professor Venkatraman Radhakrishnan. He was born in Tondiyarpet of Madras Presidency on 18th May 1929. Okay. He was an internationally renowned radio astronomer. Okay. And we already seen the story of Dr. C.V. Raman, right? We know Dr. C.V. Raman, the first Nobel laureate in science from India, okay, rather from Asia. So Professor Radhakrishnan was a son of Dr. C.V. Raman. And he was also cousin of another Nobel Prize winner, Subramanian Chandrasekhar. So he belonged to a family of Nobel Prize winners, right? And like his father, he was also a scientist. He graduated in physics at the Central College of Bangalore from the Mysore University in 1950. He was widely known as RED, okay, by his initials. And he started his research career as a research scholar at the Indian Institute of Science, IISc, Bangalore in 1951. Then he went to UK, Sweden, Australia, and spent a lot of time there doing the research. His team was the first to calculate the magnetic field of Jupiter. Okay, he was heavily into the research on the astronomical objects, space objects. So his team was the first to calculate the magnetic field of Jupiter. He did an outstanding work in the understanding of pulsars, leading to a better understanding of neutron stars. Okay. So neutron stars are the certain category of stars. Okay, when the star, so they did a lot of research in this area. This was in the 1960s, when there was hardly much information about those type of objects. And also the pulsars. Pulsars are also a type of big stars. So his comprehensive work made him one of the world's leading experts on pulsars. He has contributed to the fields of planetary radiation, interstellar hydrogen, radio source polarization, and pulsar radiation. A lot of things related to astronomy, especially the radio astronomy. Okay, the radio frequency of stars and calculating a magnetic field and other properties of stars and planets. He spent many years on the design, fabrication, and testing of the ultralight aircrafts and sailing vessels as well. So in other fields also he contributed. He returned to India in 1970 and headed Raman Research Institute, which is RRI, founded by his father, the Raman Research Institute in Bangalore. So he now headed that. And at that time, it was not in a very good shape. So he played a major role in the revival of RRI and established successful programs in the fields of radio astronomy and liquid crystals. And as an expert, he served on various national international committees of and scientific bodies related to astronomy and astrophysics. Okay. So that's the contribution of Professor Venkatraman Radhakrishnan. Okay. And this is the Raman Research Institute, which he headed and revived. Okay. And this is the logo of RRI. Till date, it is considered a very prestigious science institute. So this is the story of Professor Radhakrishnan, okay, also known as RADS. The next story, let's go back to the 1857, the first war of independence against the British East India Company. Okay. Now, so this is the story of Nana Saheb. Okay. So Nana Saheb was born as Dondu Pant on 19th May 1824 in Bithur. His father, Narayan Bhatt, was a courtier, a darbari in the court of Peshwa Bajirao II, who was a Maratha samrat. So Peshwa Bajirao II was childless. He didn't have any kids. So he adopted Nana Saheb in 1827, okay, when Nana Saheb was just the age of 3, and made Nana Saheb his political heir. So Uttaradhikari, okay, so he appointed him as his head. So Nana Saheb then studied Sanskrit and was known for the deep religious nature. Okay, he was quite a scholar. And he grew up in the companies of Tatya Tope, Azimullah Khan, and Manikarnika Tambe. So Manikarnika Tambe later became famous as Rani Lakshmibai. So they were childhood friends, actually, and they grew up together. Now, the turning point came when the Peshwa Bajirao II died. So after that, East India Company, which was a British company, they stopped their annual pension and they refused to recognize Nana Saheb as the next Peshwa. Okay. Why? Because he was not a natural son, he was an adopted son. So British refused to recognize Nana Saheb as Peshwa. Nana Saheb made an appeal against this, but it was also rejected. So this made him hostile towards the British. This was a time when the East India Company had kind of a grip the nation. Okay, they were controlling these kings, okay, and the kingdoms. Okay, so these kingdoms were dependent on East India Company for a lot of things. But Nana Saheb became hostile towards British after this incident. And when 1857 revolt started, okay, we know the famous case of Mangal Pandey started from okay. And then it spread across India. So Nana Saheb led the Kanpur rebellion in June 1857 against General Wheeler and captured Kanpur. So he led a Kanpur rebellion. He captured Kanpur from the British, okay, for a couple of days. He became a topmost leader in the freedom struggle. But of course, the British retaliated. Okay, they under the General Havelock, they recaptured the Kanpur in July 57. So for 2 months, it was under the hold of Nana Saheb, but then British recaptured that. And Nana Saheb had to go back to Bithu, but then British captured Bithu as well. So he ran, he escaped to Nepal after that. And it is, very little is known about him after that period, what happened to him after he went to Nepal. Okay. So that's the story of Nana Saheb Peshwa. He was one of the leading figures of rebellion against British in 1857 war. Okay. So next story we have is of a Hawaldar Piru Singh Shekhawat. Okay. What we'll do, we might run out of time. Okay. So we'll try to cover this story and then we'll stop. Okay. The fourth story we'll cover next week. Okay. So our next story is from the Indian Army, and this is the story of 1947-48 war. Now, who was Hawaldar Piru Singh Shekhawat? So Company Hawaldar Piru Singh Shekhawat was born on 20th May 1918 in Junjunu, town of Rajasthan. He was enrolled in 6th Rajputana Rifles in 1936 under British Indian Army. And then he was part of the same regiment once the India got independence. What was amazing is that his father and grandfather also served in the Rajputana Rifles. So he belonged to a family of armed professionals. Okay, entire family served in the same regiment, okay, Rajputana Rifles. Now, after independence in 1947-48, the war with Pakistan started. Now, during this time, Pakistani raiders had captured the village of Tithwal in the hills of Kashmir, and also pushed a pushed to seize control over the position across the river Kishan Ganga. Okay, now Tithwal, if you see here, the Tithwal was the part of the what we now has a POK, it's a very important sector. Okay, so this is what the Pakistani had captured, and Indian Army then launched a counter attack on 11 July 1948, and Piru Singh's company, the Rajputana Rifle, was tasked to secure an important enemy post. Okay, they were tasked to recapture this part. Okay, now it was of course a hilly area, and the path to this post was a narrow ridge and directly seen by the enemy bunkers. So enemy bunkers were at the top, and they can directly see the movement of Indian Army from the bottom. So on 18 July, Piru Singh's company, which is Rajputana Rifles, launched the attack, but suffered heavy casualties. Piru Singh occupied enemy's medium machine gun post, but the rest of his team was either wounded or dead. So he was left alone, and he himself was injured. Okay, there was a grenade burst right in front of him. So his one side of face was bleeding. Okay, he was also hit on his arm. But still, he single-handedly captured two more enemy posts, okay, destroying them with a grenade. He captured the second enemy post, and at that time he was hit by the bullet in his head. But by the time he was down, he threw the grenade in the third bunker. Okay, so even though he was down, okay, he died, but he cleared the third enemy bunker as well. Okay, everyone in the third bunker also died. Okay, all the Pakistani soldiers there. So he managed to capture three enemy bunkers single-handedly, despite injuries, and ultimately he died, okay, doing his task. Okay. So he fell to his injuries, but he had bravely and selflessly completed his mission. And for his profound bravery, he was awarded nation's highest gallantry award, Padamvir Chakra. Okay. And this is the amazing act of bravery he displayed single-handedly. He did that. Okay. So that's the amazing story of Hawala Piru Singh Sekhawat. Now, do you know that Indian Army has a different regiments, right? There are Gorkha regiment, there is a Sikh regiment, there is a Rajputana Rifles, and different regiments, Jammu and Kashmir, JNK Light Infantry, and different regiments are there. And every regiment has a war cry. Do you know that? Okay, you must have seen the movie Uri, right? Or have you seen the movie?
Yes.
Uri? Yeah, so in that, okay, they shout that, yeah. Right? How is the Josh? Hi, sir. So that is a war cry. Okay, before any operation, war operation, they, okay, just to pump up, okay, themselves, they have a war cry. So how is the Josh is one war cry. They do that. Bharat Mata Ki Jai is also one of the war cry most of them follow. And different regiments have their own war cries as well. Like I give you an example, Sikh regiments has a war cry. Bole so Nihal Sat Sri Akal. Okay, that is their war cry. So do you know what is the war cry of the Rajputana Rifles? Any guess? The Rajputana Rifles, right? Do you know what is the war cry of the Rajputana Rifles? Similar to how is the Josh or Bharat Mata Ki Jai. What is their sentence? Or what is their, okay, war cry? Any idea? Anyone knows?
No.
Okay, so their war cry is Raja Ramchandra Ki Jai. Okay, so, and okay, if you get time, just Google about the war cries of Indian Army. There's a list of, okay, war cries for different regiments. Okay, and the very amazing history behind those. Okay, so with this, okay, we are ending the today's session. Okay, the next story will continue in the next session. So
there is 3 minutes.
Yes, that is 3 minutes. Okay, but I'll not be able to complete the next story. Okay. So I hope you enjoyed this session.